Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today. In this lecture, I would like to discuss about the inspection. What do you do in abdomen and what are the things that you have to see in the inspection of abdomen? So in the inspection of abdomen, first you will have to see the shape of the abdomen. This is the abdomen. First you will have to see the shape of the abdomen. The shape of the abdomen can be scaphoid normally, but sometimes whenever there is fullness, the fullness can be due to fluid, presence of fluid in the abdomen, or there can be fullness which can appear as fullness of flanks, or there can be generalized distension that can be due to fat, fluid or feces or fetus. There can also be a localized distension. In the localized distension, it can be asymmetrical. If it's asymmetrical, it can be due to liver, or it can be due to spleen, or it can be due to ovaries. Okay, that can be due to anything. These are the localized distensions. Sometimes distension can be centered around the umbilicus, and it is small, and it can be due to small bowel obstruction. Now, then once you have seen all this, then you will have to look at the umbilicus. Now, once you have completed the shape, then you'll have to see about the umbilicus. Umbilicus can be normal. Normally, it is inverted and retracted, something like this, right? If it is everted, sometimes it can be everted like this, and it can occur in umbilical hernia. This eversion of umbilicus, it can occur in umbilical hernia. And then if you see, sometimes there can be some squamous epithelium or debris which is seen in the umbilicus, and that is called as omphalolith, that is a stone in the umbilical. Then umbilicus can be sometimes slit-like. This is the umbilicus, it can be slit like. This can be due to, this slit can be horizontal slit like this. This horizontal slit is due to cirrhosis of liver. Or sometimes it can be vertical slit like this. Vertical slit. If this vertical slit is, can be due to ovarian or pelvic tumors. In ovarian or pelvic tumors, you see vertical slit. Whereas in cirrhosis of liver, you see horizontal slit. Okay. Then you will have to look at the movements. So in the movements, you will have to see the normal movements, that is whether the abdomen is moving normally on inspection or not, that you should see. And if there is an abdomen is still, it can be still without any movements, that occurs, no movements occurs in peritonitis. In peritonitis, you may not see any movements. Okay. Then you will have to see about the visible pulsations. The visible pulsations are due to the, it can be due to abdominal or abdominal, it can be due to aortic. So aortic aneurysm, whenever there is aortic aneurysm, then there are aortic pulsations. So these are important. And then you will have to look at visible gastric peristalsis. Visible gastric peristalsis, here it occurs in the epigastric region where the peristalsis may be visible. This occurs from like this, there will be peristalsis is visible. This is seen in gastric outlet obstruction. Okay, gastric outlet obstruction, and sometimes you will also see small bowel peristalsis. Okay, so this small bowel peristalsis, this is seen in small bowel obstruction. Okay, in either types of obstruction, you will see the peristalsis. Visible gastric peristalsis and visible intestinal peristalsis. Next, you will then have to see the surface of abdomen. So in the surface of the abdomen, you can see sometimes presence of brownish or dark colored or whitish or pinkish linear marks can be seen. Sometimes whitish or pinkish linear marks can be seen. And these linear marks are called as striae atrophica or striae gravidarum. These are produced by stretching of skin. Then there can be also purple stria. These purple stria are seen in Cushing syndrome, purple stria. Okay, this is striae gravidarum, right? Striae gravidarum. And then sometimes around the umbilicus you see superficial veins. Okay, superficial veins around the umbilicus, this is called as caput medusae. So you see a stria purple stria, stria gravidarum, and caput per medusae. You'll have to go to the palpation. So in the palpation, first you do a superficial palpation and then you do a deep palpation. So when you do a superficial palpation, that is for whether there is any tenderness or not. That is, for that you will just do a superficial palpation. Now, then you'll have to palpate for the most important ones. You have palpated superficial palpation for just tenderness, and then you'll have to palpate for deep palpation. So in the deep palpation, you'll have to palpate first for liver, and then you'll have to palpate for spleen. So for the liver, you'll have to place the hands flat on the abdomen with fingers pointing upwards, okay, and slowly you will have to move it upwards from the right iliac fossa to right hypochondrial region, okay, and you'll have to press firmly inwards and upwards and keep it steady while the patient takes a deep breath through the mouth. You'll have to ask the person to take deep breath through the mouth, and while he's keeping it, this hand is left steady, okay, is put steady. And then you'll have to wait for full phase of inspiration and full phase of respiration. And once one phase of respiration is over, and then you will ascend up, okay, and continue it till you will palpate the edge of the liver, okay. That is the palpation of liver. The second method is, you don't go from the left iliac, right iliac fossa to right hypochondrium. You directly put it over the parallel to the costal margin. So once you put it parallel to the costal margin, then you can find the radial border of the liver. You will find the inferior border of the liver, which is felt against the index finger. Okay, don't place the hand over the rectus abdominis. If you place the hand over the rectus abdominis, which is present here, you will not see any of the findings. Okay, then that is for palpation of liver. Next, you will have to palpate the spleen. Okay, so for the palpation of spleen, there are two different methods for palpation of the spleen. One is supine position. So in the supine position, the spleen will be present here and it will grow in this way, okay, grow in this direction. So because the spleen grows in this direction, we will have to palpate with our fingers from the right iliac fossa to left hypochondrium. This is the way that we palpate. Why? Because the spleen enlarges laterally in this direction. Now, first you'll have to put your hand in the same as liver. You will have to put your hand here in the left iliac fossa. So from there, you'll have to, at the height, so in the spleen, you'll have to put your hand, and then at the height of inspiration, you'll have to release it. You'll have to put your hand, wait for one full respiration. At the height of next phase, at the height of inspiration, you'll have to release the hand, release the pressure on the abdominal hand. Like that, you'll have to go upwards. Okay, if the spleen is not palpable even that, then you will have to try to move your fingers below the costal margin. Just try to move your fingertips under the costal margin. If your fingertips can go under the costal margin, then it's not a problem. The spleen is not enlarged. Okay, that is one thing. If still, even after you are going under the costal margin, even then it is not palpable, then you will have to put the patient in left lateral position. Now, in this situation, you'll have to put the patient in left lateral position, and in the left lateral position, you'll have to keep the hips and knee flexed like this, and you'll have to put him in right lateral position, so that the spleen will be above. Okay. Now you'll have to place other hand posteriorly. Here you'll have to place, if this is the body, okay, you'll have to place one hand posteriorly here. You'll have to ask him to place one hand posteriorly and in the anterior to support the rib cage, and then you will have to try to incinerate the fingers below the costal margin again. Okay, that is one way of palpation. And there is one more way of palpation, which is called Middleton's maneuver. the other way of palpation, that is called as Middleton's maneuver. Okay, in the Middleton's maneuver, the examiner will stand over the left side of the patient. Okay, the examiner will stand over the left side of the patient facing the foot end of the bed. In such situation, the patient will turn to the right side in such a way that the spleen is above. Okay, and then he will try to hook his fingers of the left hand under the costal margin with right hand pressure exerted over the posterior lateral aspect of the thorax. If he is able to hook his fingers, then it is the spleen is not palpable. So this is how you palpate the spleen. Okay, so you'll have to palpate the spleen. Once you have palpated the spleen, you should even palpate the kidneys. So in the palpation of the kidneys, you'll have to do a bimanual palpation of the kidneys, where you put two hands. First, you put one hand posteriorly below the rib cage and the other hand anteriorly in the lower rib cage, and then you will, with the two hands, you will have to push the two hands firmly but gently as the patient breathes out, and then you will feel the lower pole of the patient, lower pole of the kidney as the patient breathes in deeply. Try to trap the palpable kidney between the two hands by delaying application pressure until the end of the inspiration. Then you will have to look at tenderness. So in the tenderness, you will have to see, as I have said, in the tenderness you will even see some more things. One, you will see whether there is any rebound tenderness. If tenderness is present, then you will see whether there is rebound tenderness. How are you going to find for rebound tenderness? Rebound tenderness is, you will apply a sharp pressure over the painful area and then it will release it. While you are doing that, the patient experiences sharp pain. Then there can be even shifting tenderness also. There can be shifting tenderness. So what does this shifting tenderness do? This shifting tenderness, this is mainly for acute non-specific mesenteric adenitis, where the tenderness will shift from one place to one side to other side. There can be referred or local tenderness. If there is referred or local tenderness, it can occur in acute appendicitis. So these are the different types of things which you have to see on palpation. So once you are done with palpation, then you will have to percuss it. Okay, just a minute. Now you will have to look for percussion. So in the percussion, now you will have to see first liver. So in the liver, you will have to first, here in the for percussing the liver, you will, I'm sorry, for percussing the liver, you will have to start from the nipples. You'll have to start percussing from the nipples, just below the nipples or just above the nipples. So from the nipples, you'll have to start percussing and you'll have to come downwards. So at a stage, you will see dullness. Mostly it is heard at fifth intercostal space. You will see dullness, and from there you will have to percuss downwards. Normally you will have dullness seen at the fifth intercostal space. There are some spaces where the dullness, some places where the dullness may not be in fifth intercostal space. The dullness can decrease in some conditions. So if this is the liver, and this is the diaphragm, this is the liver. Okay, what are the conditions where the dullness can decrease? The dullness can decrease in conditions, this is the peripleural space. Okay, that the dullness can decrease in some conditions where there is liver is enlarged. Liver can be enlarged in emphysema. In emphysema, there is trapping of air in the lung. So as a result, lung can a little enlarge. And then it can also occur in pneumothorax, because air is there in the pleural cavity, and this air will push the diaphragm downwards and push the liver downwards. So as a result, the dullness will be decreased. And you can also see whenever there is gas in the peritoneal cavity, that is under the diaphragm. Now under the diaphragm there is gas, that is pneumoperitoneum. okay, there is gas under the diaphragm, okay, even in that case the dullness over the liver will decrease. Then you will have to count for liver span. You will have to measure for liver span. Liver span is measured directly from the fifth intercostal space where you see the dullness. So you will see where the dullness is felt. So if you have felt here the dullness, you will have to mark here, and then you will have to palpate the lower costal margin. Think that the lower costal margin, lower border of the liver, inferior border of the liver. Think that inferior border of the liver is here. Now you will have to measure this distance. This distance is called as liver span. This liver span is around 12 to 15 centimeters. Okay. Then you will have to see, that is what we do for liver. The liver span, and then how much you will even have to mention how much centimeters of liver enlargement is there below the costal margin. Okay. These are the things which you see, and then you will have to look after the spleen. So in the spleen, you will have, there are different methods of palpation of spleen. You'll have to just know the methods of palpation of spleen. The first type of, first method of palpation is called as Nixon's method. In the Nixon's method, the patient is placed on the right side so that the spleen lies above the colon. The patient is now placed on right side. Okay. So that the spleen which is there, that this, the spleen will be here. The spleen lies over the, above the colon and stomach. So these will be the buttocks, and from there these are the legs. Okay. Now what do we do is, now we will percus from here. Okay. We have to percus from the front. Okay. And then you will percus, begin percussion in the lower level of pulmonary resonance in the posterior axillary line. So in the posterior axillary line, which is somewhere here, in the posterior axillary line, you will start to percuss from the lower level of the pulmonary resonance. And then from there, you will go diagonally, you will come from here and you will go diagonally along the perpendicular line towards the anterior. See, this is the perpendicular line. You will go a little diagonally perpendicular to this line, along a perpendicular line towards the lower mid anterior costal margin. See, you'll have to go to here, lower mid anterior costal margin, perpendicularly like this. Okay. And then you will feel the upper border of dullness. Normally the dullness in Nixon's method, it is 6 to 8 centimeters above the costal margin. It is 6 to 8 centimeters above the costal margin. You will see the dullness. If the dullness is more than 8 centimeters, then you can say that there is splenic enlargement. That is splenomegaly. That is Nixon's method. The next method of palpation is the second one, which is called as Castell's method. So in the Castell's method, the patient is in supine position now. Here the patient will be in supine position, and the percussion will be done from the lowest intercostal space. Here we will start our percussion. From here, you will start a percussion from the lowest intercostal space in the anterior axillary line, but not in the midclavicular line. Here you will start from the anterior axillary line in the lowest intercostal space, and this produces a resonant note. If there is splenomegaly, that produces a dull note. These are the things which you see for splenomegaly and the liver. Now in the percussion, you will have to see one more thing, which is called as shifting dullness for fluid in abdomen. So what are the tests? Okay, I'll tell like this. For fluid in abdomen, what are the tests that you do? Okay, so for fluid in dullness, if the fluid is more than 2000 ml, that is, this is the abdominal cavity. Okay, here there are the viscera. There is a 2000 ml of the fluid which is filling the complete abdomen. Okay, so because there is 2000 ml of fluid which is filling complete abdomen, you will see a fluid thrill. Okay, so what is a fluid thrill? In the fluid thrill, if this is the abdomen, okay, if this is the umbilicus, okay, what I will ask the person to do is, I will ask the person to put his hand here, okay, or to put a book, okay, to put a book or hand in the middle of the abdomen, and now I will put one of my hand over here, okay, and the other hand here, and I will give a flickering movement. Okay, I'll just give a pressure over this hand, and then we will have to feel the pressure here. because there is completely liquid here in the fluid in the abdomen that is completely filled with fluid. So as a result, when you give flickering movement here, you will find the fluid in this place, okay? In the opposite side, you will find the thrill which you see. So if you find the thrill, then you can say that fluid thrill is positive, okay? Then the next thing which is important is shifting dullness. This is done on palpation, okay? This fluid thrill is done on palpation. Then the next important thing is shifting dullness. If the fluid is around 1000 ml, okay, then you will see what is called as shifting dullness. So what is shifting dullness? So shifting dullness is if the person is now, okay, like this. Okay, if the person is like this. Now in the abdominal cavity, there is fluid, okay, but that fluid is only 1000 ml. So if it's 2000 ml, it completely fills. If 1000 ml, it is complete, it fills only partially. Okay. Now, when the person is lying in supine position like this, okay, in such cases, the fluid which is there, because of the gravity, here there will be intestines. Okay. The fluid will not be above the intestines. The fluid now accumulates in the flanks. The fluid now accumulates in the flanks. So, because the fluid now accumulates in the flanks, so always we will start our percussion from the umbilicus in the midline by keeping the hand longitudinally. Longitudinally, we'll have to keep the hand and we will go like this. Okay, we'll percuss in this way. So, once you percuss like this, you will hear a resonant note here. And then as you go laterally here, because of the presence of fluid, you will hear a dull note. Okay. So you will hear a dull note. Once, as soon as you hear a dull note, now you will put the person in left lateral position like this. Okay. You will put the person in left lateral position. You put your hand like this. You will put the person in left lateral position. Now, once you put the hand of a patient in the left lateral position, the fluid which is generally present here, that will go to the dependent part. Okay, now this fluid will completely go in the dependent part and you will not find any fluid here. Okay, and then the fluid here will completely go to the left lateral part and now you will not have any fluid here. Okay. So once you wait for 5 to 10 minutes, because it takes 5 to 10 minutes for the fluid to fill here. So once there is 5 to 10 minutes was over, once it takes 5 to 10 minutes to fill the fluid here, then you will find that the place here, now it becomes resonant. Because all the fluid which is there, that has shifted to the opposite side. So this is called as shifting dullness. This is noted whenever there is 1000 ml of fluid. This is important. Okay, now the next thing is if there is only thing that there is only 120 ml of fluid, then in such cases it is very less fluid, then you can't do either shifting dullness or you can't do either fluid thrill. In such cases you will have to do what is called as Poodle sign. In the Poodle sign, you will have to ask the person to kneel down in knee elbow position. This is the knees should be like this and elbow should be like this, and here there will be umbilicus, here the body will be like this. You will have to ask the person to kneel down in knee elbow position. In knee elbow position, and then you will have to palpate here. Okay, you'll have to palpate here. Once you palpate here, you will hear, because you are making it dependent position, all the fluid, even the small amount of fluid that is there, that gets accumulated here. Okay, so because of that, you will find a dull note around the umbilicus. Sometimes you can even put a stethoscope over the umbilicus and then around the umbilicus, and then you can scratch the abdominal wall peripherally towards the umbilicus. See, if this is the umbilicus, you will scratch the abdominal wall towards the umbilicus. Once you scratch the abdominal wall towards the umbilicus, you will see the change in quality of fluid on crossing or crossing of fluid is seen. Okay, then this is what you do for this fluid in abdomen. Then you will have to do auscultation. Once you auscultate it, you will just find vowel sounds can be found. These vowel sounds are increased whenever there is obstruction. It can be simple obstruction or acute obstruction, mechanical obstruction, or small bowel obstruction. In any type of obstruction, these vowel sounds are increased. There can be malabsorption also. Even in that, their vowel sounds are increased. In severe GI bleeding, vowel sounds are increased. In carcinoid syndrome, vowel sounds are increased. These vowel sounds are absent in paralytic ileus and peritonitis. They are absent in paralytic ileus and peritonitis. They are increased in simple acute mechanical small bowel obstruction, malabsorption, severe GI bleeding, and carcinoid syndrome. Then there are some other additional sounds which can occur on auscultation. One is called as succession splash. So what are you going to see in succession splash? In succession splash, it is a sound which is seen on shaking the abdomen. You are going to shake it. Whenever you shake the abdomen, you can hear some sound of shaking a half-filled bottle. Okay, so that is succession splash. It is seen whenever there is pyloric stenosis or any intestinal obstruction. Truly speaking, pyloric stenosis or any intestinal obstruction. In such cases, you can hear the succession splash. And then you will have to see bruit. Bruit is mainly heard over the umbilicus on the left side of the umbilicus. You'll have to see about the bruit. Where do you hear the bruit now? If this is the umbilicus, now the bruit which is there, that bruit is heard over the, this is the left thing that you will hear here over the left side of umbilicus. Because this umbilicus is just present through the left or here. So, this is the aorta. So because of the aorta, you will see bruit. You will hear bruit over the left to the umbilicus. It is most common either in aortic aneurysm, aortic or femoral aneurysm. Any aneurysms, you can hear this bruit in the abdomen. And then over the liver also you can hear the bruit. This occurs whenever there is hemangioma, okay, or hepatocellular carcinoma or alcoholic hepatitis. In that cases, or hepatic artery aneurysm, in such cases you will hear bruit. And there can be venous hum also. This venous hum is heard between the xiphoid sternum and the umbilicus. Between the xiphoid sternum and the umbilicus, you will hear a venous hum. Why is there venous hum between xiphoid sternum and umbilicus? This is because of the developed collaterals due to portal hypertension. Due to portal hypertension, there is developed collaterals, and because of that, you will hear venous hum, and this venous hum is called as Kruwelher. Baumgarten. Kruwelher Baumgarten syndrome. That is Kruwelher Baumgarten syndrome. Okay, then you will have to see if there is any frictional rub in perisplenitis or splenitis. These are the different things which you see in abdominal examination. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. Thank you.